Dear friends, may I, on behalf of GIC and Temasek, MAS and EDB, thank all of you for your participation at the third Singapore Summit. It has gained some traction, and the attendance and the quality of attendance has been improving. We would like to think that it's because of our organizational ability, but I think it is much deeper than that. I think we're all here trying to make sense of some of the changes swirling around us. Since last year, the global economy is still muddling along. I read carefully Federal Reserve Chairman Yellen's announcement a few days ago. QE was stopped in October, but very low interest rates will continue for a considerable period of time because there's slackness in the labor market. Very carefully crafted, reflecting the fact that while the US economy is showing growth, it is still fragile and somewhat uncertain. And while in the US, QE is being turned down, in Europe, it is just being started, also in October, but in the opposite direction. And for good reason, because the European economies are in the doldrums. And the conflict over Ukraine, the standoff with Russia, these have not helped. And now, our common revulsion against what's happening in Syria and in Iraq. In Japan, the third arrow is still finding its mark, but Prime Minister Abe's leadership and determination are impressive. But we've got to wait and see. In the meantime, developing Asia, despite many problems, continues to do well. And we are seeing slower growth, but higher quality growth. China, of course, is the big drama. Last year, we talked about the anti-corruption struggle. At a Politburo meeting in June this year, President Xi Jinping described it as a life and death struggle, and reminded everyone of what Zhu Rongji said when he became premier about preparing 100 coffins, 99 for those he was going after, and one for himself. In fact, it's remarkable how, within a relatively short period of time, President Xi Jinping has been able to take over command. And his authority is no longer in question, both domestically and internationally. And he has set a different tone. Economically, the measures have dampened the economy. And for multinationals, China is becoming harder. For Chinese companies, China has also become harder. But the organic vitality is still unmistakable. Before the global financial crisis, for my company, our China business, 80% consisted of taking things out from China to the developed world. After the global financial crisis, 2/3 of our China business consisted of bringing stuff into China. So while high brands have become less popular, mass consumption, mass fashion have become more important, and it is all over China. Xi Jinping has just left India, and his visit to India bears careful analysis. Under Prime Minister Modi, there's a new spirit in India, and he may have a honeymoon of maybe 2 years. And he knows that he must move fast because his campaign slogan was, "The good times are coming." And as everywhere, the electorate is impatient and fickle. And already in many local elections, the BJP has lost ground. So Prime Minister Modi knows that the economic agenda is critical to his long-term agenda of strengthening India and taking it to the front rank of major countries in the world. And the way he's managed relationship with China has implications for all of us. We read how President Xi Jinping was the first foreign leader to congratulate Prime Minister Modi when he became Prime Minister. Now let us remind ourselves that who is the first to congratulate Prime Minister Modi depended not on who called first, but whose call he wanted to receive first. So Prime Minister Modi decided that for various reasons, he will receive the call from President Xi Jinping first. When he went to Japan, he was very careful to show that he was not going to get involved in some coalition against China. So in Tokyo, repeatedly, cooing noises towards China. And Xi Jinping went first to Ahmedabad. Modi was celebrating his 64th birthday. And along the banks of the Sabarmati River, a big party, vegetarian food served, great warmth. President Xi Jinping responded in kind, promising industrial estate investments in Gujarat. But it was in Delhi where the formal statements were made by both leaders. And I would strongly recommend that you read those statements because they say a lot about what's happening between two countries which together make up 35 to 40% of the world and provide a higher proportion of global brain power. Among various things like $20 billion investments in 5 years, a more than doubling of trade in 5 years, China investing in railroads and infrastructure, in manufacturing, cooperation in peaceful use of nuclear energy, there was a curious agreement that an important place of pilgrimage in Tibet, the homeland of Lord Shiva, Kailash Mansa Mova, would be accessible via an obscure mountain pass of great strategic importance called the Nathula Pass, which is squeezed between Sikkim and Bhutan. For Indian strategic thinkers, that pass is of absolute importance because it can break India from its eastern portion. And when Indira Gandhi many years ago moved into Bangladesh, she waited till winter time when that pass was filled with snow and China could not intervene. China has agreed that there will be a second pilgrimage route to Kailash Mansa Mova through the Nathula Pass. This means India is now envisaging an opening of a new major channel of communication across the high Himalayas to China. There are big implications. If Prime Minister Modi succeeds in his economic development and in consolidating, and has a good five-year term, the relationship between China and India will be transformed. And as they themselves said in Delhi, if both of us agree on any issue, the whole world has to take note. India and China are both ancient civilizations, and this re-encounter between them will have the greatest importance in the years to come. Southeast Asia is in between. We have China, India both growing organically, and Southeast Asia benefiting powerfully from this growth. And in fact, there are some reports that last year, Southeast Asia received more investments, foreign investments than China, partly because China itself is investing in Southeast Asia. And we are seeing here a new growth surge powered by two major trends. One is coastal China has become expensive, and factories are relocating either inland to cities like Xi'an, Chengdu, Chongqing, Wuhan, Kunming, where logistics are still difficult, or into Southeast Asia, where logistics are simpler. In North Vietnam, between the border and Hanoi, Samsung, Foxconn have invested billions of dollars into electronic manufacturing facilities. And the road connecting Vietnam to China between Hanoi and Nanning, on the Chinese side is all highways, six lanes. On the Vietnamese side, highway being built. Philippines, Cambodia, Indonesia. It's a positive story. Let me just touch on two. Thailand and Indonesia. In Thailand, some of us look askance at the army moving in again. We should look deeper than that. Thai society is going through a critical transition in its history because the king is aging. And unlike in 2006, when the army stayed on a year and dismounted with the deeper problems largely unresolved, this time round, the Thai army has decided to hang around a few years to make sure that during the transition, nothing will fall in between. A civilian government has been formed, but soldiers have changed their uniforms to civilians, so that doesn't really count. But by the end of next year, there will be elections, but under a new constitution. And the Thais expect that under the new constitution, the army will continue to play a special role. The Western countries will sniff at all this. But in Asia, in ASEAN, for India, China, Japan, they will take a different view. For us in business, it's worth our while to stay invested in Thailand because I believe long-term stability is good for Thailand, good for Southeast Asia. And democracy, if it doesn't deliver good government, may have to be attenuated here and there in order so that good government may be achieved. But of course, it mustn't, in resolving the shorter-term issues, create longer-term problems. And in the case of Indonesia, it is a story where democratic arrangements have developed a remarkable stability. Last year, Yusuf Kalla, now Vice President-elect, addressed this. Jokowi, Yusuf Kalla, that combination will create a new situation in Indonesia. Watch how they handle the reduction of fuel subsidies. If it's watered down, then the signal is a bad start. If it's decisive, and there's an uproar and demonstrations, but they follow through, then invest in Indonesia. Because it shows will, it shows determination, it shows that many problems of infrastructural bottlenecks, of regulatory reforms, of cronyism will be tackled. But these are things before us, and by the time we meet again next year, the picture will be clearer. But on the whole, I think we have reasons to be bullish about ASEAN. And if you add together China, ASEAN, India, that's half the world's population. Are there problems? Yes, of course there are problems. There are problems everywhere. But problems of a very different kind from the problems in the Ukraine or in the Middle East. And we are very fortunate that Singapore is smack right in the middle of that happier half of the world. What are the possible problems? There are two levels. Sino-US relations, Sino-Japan relations, South China Sea. Maybe Sino-Vietnam relations. But they all turn on Sino-US relations. In the US now, there is growing concern about China's growth. And one can sense reading the media and the journals that anti-China sentiments are on the rise. And in dark rooms, dark thoughts are being nursed. So too, on the China side. But at the leadership level, there's a recognition that that relationship is too important, the interdependence is so great, the cost of a fallout too dramatic for that relationship to be mismanaged. Over the South China Sea, there appeared to have been a possible triggering point. But since then, the temperature has come down. And between Vietnam and China, and here one must distinguish between the relationship between foreign ministries and the relationship between the communist parties. Between foreign ministries, there is a standoff. But between the two communist parties, which are the two oldest communist parties in the world, the relationship remains profound. And recently, the Vietnamese sent one of the top leaders from the Communist Party to China, met Xi Jinping, and I was reading the Chinese reports, and it was put in a positive way. So I think there are reasons not to be too pessimistic about the South China Sea. Between China and Japan, it turns on China and the US. Susan Rice's visit to China recently, the strategic dialogue, which my good friend Bob Zalek initiated some years ago. Xi Jinping's repeated statements that China will make relentless efforts to push forward what the Chinese call the Xing Xing Da Guo Guan Si, the new model of big power relations, is not to be questioned. Because China knows that if that relationship falters, every other calculation will have to shift. And from the US side, the US needs China to solve many of the world's problems. Ukraine, the Middle East, the Ebola virus, the role of the US dollar in the world. So I believe, despite difficulties, and there could be occasional hiccups, and accidents could happen in the East Asian Sea or in the South China Sea, things could happen, like they did in 2001 April, when the US civilian aeroplane collided with a Chinese fighter jet, and the crew was detained for a period on Hainan Island. Things could happen, but so long as at a strategic level between the leaders, they maintain calm and maintain a strategic discipline, you'll be okay. So on balance, while from time to time there could be anxious moments, I think the picture in Asia is not bad. And I think it's partly for this reason that the Singapore summit will grow in importance. But there's a second set of problems which arises not from geopolitics, but from the effect that technology is creating on all hierarchical structures. I mean, the recent referendum on Scotland, I think, is an example of this. What's the pressure? The pressure is with disintermediation of hierarchies, There is a pressing need for greater devolution of power everywhere, and for leadership no longer to be hierarchical, but more inspirational. And everywhere, for the same deep reasons, middle classes are becoming unhappy because despite all the efforts in working hard, in being responsible, they are competing against computers, algorithms, new supplies of competitors in the developing world. We see in the West, we see in Hong Kong, we see in Singapore, we see in Britain, we see in Spain, we see in Eastern Europe. It's a global phenomenon. So governments are under pressure to take from the rich to help these middle classes. But that's a 20th century solution which will not work because capital talent will flee. And in the end, to face this challenge, we cannot avoid the moral question of growth and inequality. That in the end, the problem of mass unhappiness among global middle classes is a moral question of what it means to be a member of a community. And there's a greater desire that, look, we want more autonomy. Far away in Beijing, in Tokyo, in Brussels, in London, the leaders live in their own world. They do not know our circumstances, how we feel, the things we go through. They don't understand why, but so they listen to people who make simple appeals. And that can be dangerous. But this is a question which we are, who are in business, cannot close our eyes to. I remember early this year in Davos, Klaus Schwab had invited the Holy Father to speak. He sent a cardinal there to deliver a message, reminding everybody that yes, it's good to meet and to talk about business and to promote growth, but please don't forget, in the end, what is it all for? It is for the human being. And maybe in the course of our discussions today, we should not neglect that moral dimension. And it'll be a full day today. We're keeping it short. We'll end by 4:35 o'clock, keeping it compact. In the morning, we talk about the growth of the Asian economies, about integration, about the regional CEP versus the Trans-Pacific Partnership. We'll talk about Xi Jinping visiting Jakarta last year, saying that let the trade between ASEAN and China grow from $400 billion in 2012 to $1 trillion by 2020. We'll talk about all those things. Then we will have Sri Mulyani as our distinguished speaker. She's from the World Bank, but she's also from Indonesia. And I asked Nick Gawin a moment earlier on, please set aside some time for questions on Indonesia. Because Indonesia is a big country, it is almost half of ASEAN, and how Indonesia performs in the coming years will affect all of us in ASEAN in many ways. Then after that, Prime Minister will join us for lunch, and he's agreed to an open dialogue, nothing but, and please make full use of the opportunity to ask any question you wish. Ambassador Chan Hing Chi will chair the session. It's less than an hour, so she will have to be a schoolmistress and be very strict. No verbosity, please. Short, sharp questions collected together so that the time is maximally used. In the afternoon, first session on risk, we talk about geopolitics, we talk about geoeconomics, we talk about the things which worry us. And there are many things which should worry us. The last session focused on energy. I remember Lee Raymond telling me years ago that China's foreign policy will increasingly be dictated by China's energy needs. And this is perhaps a perspective which applies not only to China, but all over the world. You can't have growth without energy. Whoever can, like in the biological world, whoever can optimize the use of energy will have a great Darwinian advantage. So in fact, one way to analyze the quality of a government is its energy policy. if this energy policy is bad, you see pollution, high subsidies, traffic jams, all kinds of absurdities. If energy policy is sensible, many things work well. And I remember Emery Lovin of Rocky Mountain Institute telling me some years ago, when I asked him about the Chinese government's approach towards energy, he said, no other government takes energy strategy and policy as seriously as the Chinese government. And that was many years ago. So it's like a dipstick, like a thermometer into the quality of governance in the country. So we are going to talk about many things, about technology, the impact of shale oil and gas. We're going to talk about the geostrategic implications of the Middle East, on China, the Straits of Malacca. We're going to talk about alternative energy forms. It should be an interesting session. There'll be very little time to talk about everything, but it should be interesting. And then by 4:30, we should wrap up, leaving you a free late afternoon and evening for your other affairs. And tomorrow, we meet again for the round table, those of us who are involved in it. And then there's the F1 party in the afternoon and evening. Thank you all for coming, and we look forward to an interesting day. But please don't forget, Chatham House rules, apart from Sri Mulyani's presentation and Prime Minister's dialogue, if you want to quote anyone else during the sessions, please ask for his permission. Thank you very much.